We're now going to find the general solution to this fundamental lifting line equation. So remember, we derived this equation. This is the fundamental lifting line equation. And the only unknown is gamma of z, our distribution of gamma. So it shows up in this term here, and then also the derivative inside of this integral here. Now, we're going to solve this in the most general form. And in the most general form, these terms on the right-hand side, both can actually be functions of z. So the angle of attack can be a function of z. That's the geometric twist in the wing. It can be twisted, so it's a function of z. Or the zero lift angle of attack can be a function of z. This is the aerodynamic twist in the wing. So both geometric and aerodynamic twist can be functions of z. And so again, the only unknown here is gamma of z. So let's look at how we would solve this now, just in a general form. So let's start by just looking at what this wing looks like. And remember, we have some trailing vorticity coming back here in the x direction. This is y, and then we have z out the right wing. And then a typical lift distribution looks something like this. We know that it has to go to zero at the wingtips, because the wingtip cannot withstand a pressure difference between the upper and the lower surface. And so the lift has to go to zero at that point. So we're going to do a change of variables. And actually, if you were to look at this just straight on, our lift distribution will look something like this. And we're going to use z along this axis here. And z over b, we're going to normalize that z over b. So z divided by the span means that it would go from minus 1/2 to positive 1/2. Okay. And we're going to apply a change of variables into theta. We're going to find that this is really useful. So this change of variables is defined as z over b is equal to minus 1/2 cosine of theta. Or if we solve for theta is equal to the arc cosine of negative 2 times z over b. Okay. So if we plug in a z over b of minus 1/2, what we get for theta is 0. So this is in terms of theta. So we get 0 there at minus 1/2, and at positive z over b of 1/2, or z over b of positive 1/2, we get that theta is equal to pi. Okay, so theta goes from 0 to pi. And this is really convenient because we're going to look at this in terms of a Fourier sine series. So we're going to assume that gamma of theta is equal to a Fourier sine series. So we're going to define it as 2b v infinity times a summation from n equals 1 to infinity, and an infinite number of terms here, where we have some coefficient a sub n times sine of n theta. Okay, so we're just going to assume that gamma, this vorticity distribution, can be written in terms of this Fourier sine series. And this is really convenient because sine of n times theta, where theta is either 0 or pi, always goes to 0. And so basically, this is an infinite series where all of our values here at the tip will always be 0. You know, they can have whatever content in here from the sine wave here, but at 0 and pi, or n times 0 or pi, it will always go to 0. So this is really convenient because we know that our lift has to go to 0 there, or our vorticity has to go to 0. And so that's why we choose this sine series to represent gamma. Okay, so we now need to plug in, we're just gonna take this and rewrite this entire equation in terms of theta instead of z, okay? So instead of gamma z, we're just gonna put in gamma of theta. in this term here, we need d gamma dz. And so let's figure out what that is real quick. So d gamma dz, if the first derivative of that is equal to d gamma d theta times d theta dz. And so let's see, d gamma d theta, if we just take the derivative of this, what we're going to get is 2b v infinity times the summation from n equals 1 to infinity of n times a sub n cosine of n theta. And then we have this d theta dz on the back end there. Okay, now let's just figure out what d theta dz is. We can write down here that z is equal to minus b halves times cosine of theta. And so dz, if you just take the derivative of that, is going to be b halves, positive b halves, times a sine of theta d theta. Okay, so now we have this relationship between dz d theta, which can be used in this term here. Okay, so if we now take these two expressions for gamma and the first derivative and plug it into our fundamental equation, I'm not going to work through all the algebra to make that happen. It's pretty straightforward. I'll just write the solution here. What we get is 4b over c of theta. Remember, before we had c of z, but now we're writing this whole equation in terms of theta. So that's c of theta times the summation from n equals 1 to infinity a sub n sine of n theta plus cl alpha tilde over pi. We have some terms cancel out there. And then this integral now, we used to be using zeta as our integral term there. Or a variable of integration, but and then z is at a certain point, so we have to integrate over zeta and hold z constant. So now we're going to hold a theta value constant, and we're going to use phi as our variable of integration. So we'll go from phi equals 0 to pi. So that's our new bounds of integration in terms of theta from our change of variables. And then we've got inside of that the summation from n equals 1 to infinity n times a sub n. And then once we do the change of variables here for this term here, this dz over z minus zeta, and plug in this thing here, what we get is a cosine times n phi d phi over cosine of phi minus cosine theta. Okay, and then the right hand side hasn't changed, so we still got the cl alpha tilde times alpha of theta now minus alpha l0 of theta, again from our change of variables from z to theta. Okay, so this equation is looking just as bad, but we have one saving grace here. And that is that this integral here has a summation inside of it, but these are just two constants out front here, this n times a sub n. So we can actually move this integral inside right here and move these constants out front, the summation out front. We can switch places here. And this integral from phi equals 0 to pi of this term here is a known integral. And that integral will equate to pi times sine of n theta over sine of theta. Okay, so once we do that and we've gotten rid of our integral here because we've already applied it to integrate this term here, what we're left with are two summations actually here. A summation from 1 to infinity of a sub n sine n theta, and then another summation of n times a sub n of pi sine n theta over sine theta. Okay, so these two terms will actually look really similar now, these two summation terms. And we can combine those into a single summation term that looks like this. So we're going to have from n equals 1 to infinity of a sub n sine n theta. Both of them have a sine n theta in it. And then we've got the first term had this 4b over n, and we're going to divide the whole thing through by cl alpha. So we end up with that in the denominator. And then plus, and the second term had an n over sine theta. Okay, so and then that's equal to the right-hand side, which we've divided out this cl alpha term, both sides by that. So on the right-hand side, we're just left with alpha of theta minus alpha L0 of theta, okay? So this is our final equation that we can now solve. The only unknown in here is that are these a sub n terms, these Fourier coefficients, and we just need to solve this for, we need to choose a number of coefficients that we're going to solve for. So what we usually do is we truncate this to some capital N number of coefficients that we're going to solve for, and we force it to be solved at N locations along the wing. So we usually put points at the two tips and one in the center, and then we solve for several of the locations along the wing. So for example, this would be N equals 1, 2, 3, up to N terms. And so what we're going to do is force this equation here to be satisfied at N locations along that wing, okay, including the two tips. And so by doing that, what we actually end up with is a system of equations where we have these a sub n terms that we are that we're solving for. So this is just an ax equals b type of equation here, but it's this this series of equation or the system of equations here. Okay, so we're going to choose n locations along the wing to solve that for, and at each of those locations we'll have a theta value. So we'll have, you know, theta sub I, for example, where, or theta sub n, I guess, as we loop across this. And so we'll plug that theta sub n in for any locations where we need a theta. So for example, in here. And then this will give us a system of equations that can be solved. So what we get out of this now is a vector a sub n of all of these terms that we've solved for. And once we have that, we can plug that a sub n vector back into this equation here to get gamma of theta. So we do our a sub n back into our gamma of theta equation. And that gives us our distribution of vorticity across the swing, which then, as we've seen, can be used to compute the lift and drag. And we'll go into a little bit more detail on that now.